Thank you, folks. Now that you have all rebooted yourselves, kia ora. Yes, isn't movement wonderful? Now that you've all rebooted yourselves, it's my great privilege and pleasure to introduce someone who's actually a very dear friend internationally. And, you know, when I heard that Cindy was going to be a speaker, of course I was incredibly chuffed, not just because it gave me a chance to see somebody I haven't had a chance to see for a while, but also I kind of like the idea that it's a Cindy and Cindy club. There's not many Cindys left in the world. I just want to, when I was asking Cindy how she'd like to be introduced, she said, just really brief, and that says an enormous amount, I think, about the humility of Cindy and her work. But I do want to tell just a little weeny story, one that probably implicates me more than her. Cindy actually was born and grew up, she's from the Gitxkan Nation, as you will have read in her blurb. But she told me that she actually grew up in the wilderness of the northwest of Canada, actually. And she's one pretty tough cookie, I discovered, not just in terms of her work, but grew up thinking that wolves were actually there as protectors, and is not scared of the odd bear or two, I've discovered. And so she grew up fishing and hunting and living in the wilderness of the back blocks and the far reaches of the northern province on the west coast of Canada. And I think that says a great deal, actually, about your spirit, Cindy, and what drives you, not just your nation and your commitment to First Nations children and indeed to Indigenous children through your work in the UN Indigenous Forum, but also says a great deal about you and who you are, I think, as a person. And the one little story which is really incriminating is that one of the first times and one of my earliest memories of Cindy was actually in a meeting that we had with First Nations people in Quadra Island. And I had the brainy idea of taking a group of us for a lunch break walk along Quadra Island, and we went off on a wilderness trail, ended up getting lost and walked for about 2 hours somewhere in the wilderness and came back, and I was incredibly frightened to discover that in fact a pack of bears or some bears and her cub had been seen on that very trail. Well, I have to say, Cindy was very relaxed about all that. Now I know why. Whereas I thought, thank goodness I hadn't been exposed to them. But I think, Cindy, in many ways, you are a pathfinder. I mean, you find bears and you deal with them, including federal governments of Canada. And no doubt we will hear a few stories, but always, always, it's with a deep passion and an incredible commitment to hearing the voice of children and First Nations children and Indigenous children in particular. And I think it's a great honour to us that you've made the time to come and join us here. So kia ora koe te rangatira. Haere mai.
So, Maria asked a question. She said, why are you treating kids this way? She was 5 years old. She was asking the Prime Minister of Canada because she knew. She knew it was not okay for First Nations children to get less because of who they were. Less funding from one of the richest countries in the world for education, for health, for child welfare. And she also knew that adults are there to protect her. She believed in the goodness of all of us to do the right thing, but she was puzzled why it was taking us so long. Why is it that when we know better, we can do better, we simply don't do it? An elder taught me, he said, you need 4 things to change the world. You need knowledge, and a lot of people have that. Definitely in this room, there is unbelievable knowledge. There's persistence, and a lot of you have that. Particularly when it comes to dealing with governments. You go out there and you create the evidence, you document the problem, you work on the solution, you write your submission, you meet with your member of parliament, and then they don't do anything, or they do just a little. And then you go back and you get more evidence, you get more solutions, you go back and make more submissions, and you hope that a change in government, and they do nothing, or just a little. And then he said, you need to have passion. He said, and a lot of people will criticize you for that. And he said, and our educational system strips it from our hearts and from our spirits. You need only look at how boring the average academic journal is to see evidence of that. And you need spirit, and you need to remember. We have lots of knowledge as adults back in Canada. And yes, we have had persistence. But it was not until we found the children, who are the keepers of the spirit and of the passion, that we were able to move things forward. This is a story about how kids are taking on the government of Canada and how I have been taught by them about something called mosquito advocacy. It's also a reminder that if you truly want to get at the heart of these problems, you're going to have to deal with where they're sourced, which is not in the homes or in the hearts of our children or their families. It is in the hearts and the minds of the most powerful people in the country. The most powerful people in the country. And if you're going to tackle it, you better be prepared. It is not for the faint of heart. And that's also why we need children, because they have far more courage than most adults do. This is Sheila Fraser, our Auditor General of Canada, considered to be one of the most credible and highly respected women in our country in high positions of government. She is telling you again what the Canadian government has known for decades, is that First Nations children on reserves get less funding for every critical government service than all other Canadian children. It has been going on not just for a couple of years and not just for a couple of governments. I was sharing just the other day that I read a report that said, can anyone hazard a guess as to what year or what century real progress will be made towards the equality of First Nations children? That was written in 1967. I was 3 years old. I hear governments often coming to talk at different forums around the world, and they talk about how they're making progress, and they want us to be thankful to them. And when we're not thankful enough, they get worried that we're being unfair or too hard on governments. To be honest, I'm not worried about the fairness of governments at all. I'm only worried about the fairness to children. And that's what they should be worried about as well. And that's what every Canadian should be worried about, and I would argue every citizen of the world. I don't care if the government gets hurt. I don't care if they're offended. I want them to do the right thing because it's the best thing for the country. I don't think that standing in silence in the face of discrimination is patriotic. And I don't think it's good for kids. So we had, the Auditor General has told us, and the Canadian government was moving slowly. And here are the results of the slowness. There are more First Nations children in our country in child welfare care today than there was at the height of a residential school era by a factor of 3. Driven there not by abuse, but by poverty, by poor housing, and by caregiver substance misuse related to Canada's policy of forcefully removing 5-year-olds from their families and having them raised in Christian residential schools and often abused and neglected there, only to return back to their communities being unable to speak their languages with only a grade 3 education because we were thought to be too dull to be able to absorb any kind of academic tradition. The good news is these are all solvable problems. The bad news is that the Canadian government provides less funding for First Nations child welfare than all other Canadian children enjoy. And there's another problem too, and that is that the child welfare system has not retooled itself to actually deal with these factors. Too often we codify these problems as personal deficits instead of dealing with the real issues that are presenting themselves, and that is our responsibility of those of us in child welfare. And we cannot continue to blame families for our own neglect in not retooling the system. Now, you might be wondering what the Canadian government would say about this if they were here, and I have no doubt they would talk to you about all the good things that they're doing. But it's always nice to take a little peek around the corner, behind the curtain of government, I find, and so I'm a big fan of access to information. And this is, sometimes the government actually writes these things in more kind of direct language than even I would use, and so I'm very thankful to whoever wrote this. This is a briefing note for the minister, and he's about to appear before a parliamentary committee, and he's talking about the levels of child welfare funding in our country. And as you can see there, they say circumstances are dire. I want to stop there for a minute. They're talking about our kids. Our kids. Now, as a consequence of providing inadequate prevention services, services that can keep our children safely in their families, it's foreseeable. Now, look at this. Circumstances are dire, not that a wealthy country like ours should be mobilizing all of its resources to do something to help the kids. What are we worried about? Ourselves, as a government, being sued. I'm going to say something here that's rather controversial. I think there are good and moral people in government, but the whole thing is a sociopath. It is neither moral or logical. And yet we expect it to be moral and logical, and those of us in public health policy often approach it as if it is moral and logical. And too often we have to realize that it will only look after itself. So the way to be able to address a government is to exhaust all those things, to do all those good pieces around solutions. But at some point, you stop meeting with the sociopath and you go around it to the citizens who actually have the power to knock it out. And when you go around it to the citizens, that's when the sociopathic government actually may change the sentence to circumstances are dire and we're going to do something to help the kids because a wealthy country like ours has every possibility of doing it. So what do you do? You're a small First Nations organization of four people, you're in Canada. The non-Aboriginal NGOs in our country, they're caring and great, but they aren't really working on First Nations issues. I'm gonna be honest here. We fill the back chapters of other people's reports. So there's a whole report on health, and then there's the Aboriginal health section in the back. You have worked with government for over a decade to document the problem. You've had it independently verified by credible sources like the Auditor General. The government's been at the table to discuss the solutions. Your government at the time is running a $23 billion surplus. So it's not as if we can't afford to implement it. And they walk away from it. The government bureaucrat said, you know, we're doing everything we can. If you just give us a little bit more time, we're going to do that next briefing with the government. But don't take this out, because if you do, we're going to lose control over it and we'll never be able to get it through. I've seen that same speech given by bureaucrats all over the world. We decided that we would rather... See, the other thing, too, you need to know is we were receiving government funding for our organization. But we decided that we didn't love the caring society. We weren't in love with the caring society. We were in love with the children. And I am prepared to go all in with the caring society and lose it. If it meant actually making a stand on behalf of the kids. If it meant that when the Marias look up at me and look up at our organization, they know that we cared enough about them to fight for them. And so we decided as an organization that we'd rather die on our feet than live on our knees, and so we filed a human rights complaint against government, and we allege that they're racially discriminating against our kids by underfunding child welfare services. Now, we didn't just do that. We actually created a whole campaign around it, because my own theory is that oppression does not like a witness. And maybe that's why, you know, like I arrived here in New Zealand 12:30 in the morning on Sunday, and I was met by the wonderful border control agents you have here. And the first thing they wanted to see is whether I actually had a return ticket from Canada. And when I assured them I did, they still wanted to see it. Maybe this is why, huh? So I do have a ticket. I just haven't decided whether I'm going to go to the airport or not. What we did is we created this website and we loaded all of the court documents from our side and of their side and all of the relevant reports. And we simply asked Canadians and people of the world to register to watch. We just want you to watch. We want you to make up your own mind about whether you think the Canadian government is doing the right thing by its people and actually standing on guard for the best values of Canadian citizens. Now, when we launched this thing, we weren't sure if anyone would sign up. We were thankful that now over 10,533 people have signed up. Now, Canada does not like the I Am a Witness campaign. It has not launched something similar to this. And you might think, well, that's a very powerful way of doing it, and it is. It's an interesting way of doing it. But the most effective thing is that because we're dealing with children in a UN convention, which Canada signed, says that children have a right to participate in matters affecting them, I thought, who better to come to the court than kids? Now, Canada is trying to get this thing thrown out on legal technicalities. They said the real issue here is not whether we're discriminating. We don't want to talk about that. And the reason they don't want to talk about that, in my view, is because they are discriminating. They want to talk about their own unfairness to them as a government. They want to say, we're being treated unfairly because the Caring Society and the Assembly of First Nations are saying that you can compare First Nations children to what funding other kids get. That's not fair to us as the federal government. Now, if that doesn't convince the average Canadian coming to these hearings, they have a plan B. They're saying, all we do as the federal government is provide funding for the social work. If the social workers on these First Nations communities are giving less of a service, they should be held accountable for the racial discrimination against kids, not us as the funder. Now, you're a very learned and independent international audience. Who buys either one of those arguments? So there we are in federal court. Imagine yourself, you're Canada's counsel. You're walking into a room, not just with five people. There's an overflow room. It's being held in the Supreme Court of Canada because that's the largest courtroom in the country. There are over 200 people there. But instead of just having your usual grassroots human rights groups, the First Nations, all the usual cast of characters, you have a kindergarten class in the front row. Now, the other thing is they're all wearing these hearts that say, have a heart for First Nations children, or they have a badge, and I Am a Witness badge. And the kids figure out pretty quickly who's with the government of Canada, because they're not wearing those badges. So one of the teenagers took off her badge, and she said, oh, it looks like you were missed in the crowd. Would you like to wear one of these? Because you should be watching. Now, you might be wondering what kids could get out of a court hearing as complicated as this with all that legal jargon. So I come out during the break, and there is one of those five-year-olds. And she's having her snack. Now, the problem with my constituency is I have to build in things for nap times and snack times. So I'm coming out, and there she is. And she's munching her granola bar, eating, and waving her hand at the same time. So she says, I have a question. She says, why are they talking about everything in there except for what's good for the kids? I said, that is the most important question. And that's what we want, too. We want a hearing where we talk only about what's good for the kids. If we as First Nations, after we present our evidence to the public and to our own communities and in front of the world are wrong, we should need to be held accountable for that, and we're prepared for that. But we want it to be about the kids. They want the conversation to be about the kids. So Canada in court gets its round two. And on that day, there's even more kids than usual, and we'll talk about that in a minute. So Canada's lawyer is up there, he's presenting his case. It's not fair to us. Oh my gosh, you cannot compare First Nations kids on reserve to other kids. It just doesn't make any sense, Your Honor. And then I go outside again. And there's a group of kids, and there's a boy in grade 5. And he says, Cindy, we're over here. So I go over, and he has a notebook, because his teacher said being a witness is like being a reporter. So he has a notebook, and it's like this. And he says, I want to show you something. So he had drawn a line right down the middle of the notepad. And you know the tallies, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then across 5. A whole list of them on one side of the paper. And then a list about a third as long on the other side of the paper. And he said, do you know what this is? And it was one of those awkward moments for me as a social worker and someone who works with kids. It's kind of like looking at that grade 2 drawing when they grow up and they say, do you look at this picture? Isn't it great? What do you think it is? And I'm thinking, okay. Looks like a Rorschach ink blot, but whatever is it? Anyway, he says this. He says, the long list is when the judge asks the Canada people a question. And the short list is when they answer. So the hearing went on for 3 days, and you might wonder, when Canada went out for a coffee break, what was happening outside? You see, the kids felt that the place, they didn't understand a lot about politics, but they knew that the person who could change all of this is someone called the Prime Minister of Canada. And so what they did is they had a rally outside where they wrote letters to the Prime Minister. And since it was Valentine's Day, it wasn't just regular letters. These were Valentine's Day cards. And I think you have Valentine's Day here. And when I was in grade 1, we could always tell the popular kids because they had the most in their cubbyhole, right? Well, the Prime Minister, I can tell you, received so much love on February 14th of this last year all around the country. And here are the kids, and they're reading their letters. Now, you might wonder what these kids would possibly say to the Prime Minister of Canada, what they'd even say to any of you about these issues. So up comes Elliot, and he's reading his paper, and he says, Dear Prime Minister Harper, I do not know why you're over in China criticizing their human rights when you're breaking your own laws back home. Maybe you should get on a plane and come back. And then there's Bethany, and she says, you know, dear Prime Minister Harper, I think you need to go back to grade 5, because that's where you learn about something called the Charter of Rights and Freedoms that says that you're supposed to treat everybody fairly. And if you read that thing, you would know what kids in grade 1 in my school already know, which is what you're doing is wrong. And then we had a little girl step up, and she said, Dear Prime Minister Harper, is the only reason that I get to go to a good school, grow up with my family, and be loved, and be healthy, is because I'm a non-Aboriginal girl? We want something to change for our country. We want to grow up in a place where everybody counts. We won't want to grow up in a country where people are left behind. We don't understand why this is happening. But you can see there that our rallies are not sad occasions. They're not upset. They're standing for something versus standing against something. Now, I can tell you that on April 18th of this last year, I was with a group of kids in Toronto, and we were waiting for the hearing, the results of this hearing from the Federal Court of Canada. And the kids were there, and normally I don't bring my BlackBerry when I'm talking to kids. But I told them I had to keep it out because we're going to get the ruling. And just as the kids were unrolling a big banner, a big check that they had donated to the Caring Society, I got the message. And the message was that Canada's efforts to derail the tribunal on the basis of the legal technicalities was thrown out wholeheartedly by the Federal Court of Canada. There will be a hearing. And I told the kids that, and they all jumped up and said, "We won. We won." And they did. This isn't a case in the Caring Society. This is a matter of all Canadians standing up for the right and proper thing. And you might wonder what happened to our Caring Society. I told you, I think, that we were federally funded. Well, we weren't sure how we were going to afford the lawyers that had to go against Justice, one of the biggest law firm in the country, and we weren't sure how we'd even make payroll, but somehow I remember hearing a phrase that faith is when you step apart across that place where light leads into darkness, that there will be something solid for you to stand on, or you'll be taught to fly. And it was only a couple weeks after that that a special letter came in the mail. And for reasons we're going to talk about in a moment, I'm a bit suspicious about what comes in the mail these days. And I picked up the letter, and I was going back. Tammy, who works with me, Tammy said, "Cindy, there's a special letter here for you. I think you should open it up." So I go, and I'm walking to the office, and the letter is jingling. And I get in there, and it says, "Dear," and I think this is how the Government of Canada spells my name, too, S-I-N-D-Y, right? "Here's some M-U-N-Y for the kids. Love, Ella." And inside was $1.67 for a piggy bank. Kids are the largest funders of the Caring Society. We are totally owned by the children of Canada, and they will decide whether we keep in business or not the way it should be. So how do we make all this happen? And is it something that you could do? You know, I've read a lot of books on public policy advocacy and all the rest of it. And it really assumed that you had a marketing department. Well, we did have a marketing department. They were in grade 3, though, was my challenge. And it assumed that you had lots of money. Well, we were broke. It assumed that you had all kinds of legal resources. And well, you know, at the time we did or didn't. Thankfully now, due to Steichman Elliott, one of the biggest Bay Street law firms in Toronto, has taken our case on pro bono, so it's going all the way to Supreme Court, and it's not going to cost us a dime. Thank you, Steichman Elliott. That wasn't the case at the time, so how is it that we're going to take on something as big as the Government of Canada's small little group? Now, Cindy told you I grew up in the bush, and if I was to show you a picture of my homeland, it is absolutely gorgeous. There's beautiful mountains and a river. And if you see the tourist things that come from the Government of Canada, they always show you our beautiful country. But they never show you any close-ups. Because if you look close up in the summer, we are overwhelmed with the biggest mosquito population in the country. So yes, you can be out there at Lake Louise, but you got to bring your 1,500 things of mosquito coils with you, right? Now, why is it that the mosquito is so effective, I found myself wondering. And what could it teach me about the journey we were about to take? So we developed something called mosquito advocacy based on the attributes of the mosquito. And it is only to be used, really, when you've exhausted all this stuff. You have an evidence-based solution. You've gone to the government, you've tried to get them to do the right thing, and they've done nothing, or they've only done a little bit. And they don't want to implement the change. And we're dealing with kids. I mean, that's what this whole conference is about. How long, the question for all of you is, how long are you prepared to wait? How long are you prepared to wait? Because the kids are growing up right now. It might be okay for you to wait 4 or 5 years, but what about them? That's the time from when they're a baby to the time they're in preschool. You're prepared to give all that up? So if you're not, then you got to go all in with the mosquito. And so here's how a little bit about what we do and what it's about. So there you go. What do mosquitoes do? Well, number one, they aren't saying, oh, there's all kinds of issues, and man, we're not sure which one we want to approach first. Maybe we want to go after the tree or the grass. No, they look at the biggest animal on the thing, which would be myself. They say, hey, there she is. We're going for it. Now, I am a big believer in going after what's called, I call the first domino solution, which is not the solution that solves the entire problem, but it makes solving the problem possible. So you can go and talk about all kinds of best practices in First Nations child welfare. That means squat unless we have the resources to implement it. So we go after the equity issue. That's our first domino solution. And we know how to solve it. We have it down to, we have 167 pages of economic spreadsheets that we've delivered to the Government of Canada documenting how we would spend every last dime and how it should be structured. So you have to have a solution. Go after one issue. Every one of the issues I've heard here at the conference, I can nail down to one plea. You are going to overwhelm people if you're going one issue at a time. I could do that with First Nations. I can talk about youth suicide. We could talk about poverty. We could talk about all these things. But we talk about equity, and that's important. Here's the other thing. I used to get up and do lots of talks, and I'm a quantitative researcher by training, and so I would get up and I would try to impress people with our multi-level analysis and all the rest of it. It doesn't work. I read a book, we're going to talk about it in a minute, by George Lakoff, Don't Think of an Elephant. And he said, really, there's a reason why George Bush only has five words, beyond genetics. That's because we frame language in deep cognitive frames based, and the thing that you need to do is frame your solution within the deepest values of your population. So who is literally going to stand against us when we, the children and myself and others, are standing up and saying every First Nations child deserves a chance to grow up safely with their families, be healthy, go to good schools, and be proud of who they are? It doesn't matter if you're on the right or on your left or you're in the middle. No one can disagree with that. And it's easy for everybody to understand. And when you're dealing with child health, who needs to be able to understand what you're doing the most but a four-year-old? So I always test market my ideas. I don't go up to some five-year-old and say, hey, I have got a multi-level statistical analysis and can show a p-value of 0.005 that this makes a difference. And by the way, kids are also really good at solutions. The Government of Canada, they have jurisdictional disputes that deny First Nations kids services. And they've been struggling for years to try and solve it. We already gave them a solution called Jordan's Principle. So I went to a grade 3 class. I said, the government people who get paid all kinds of money and have all kinds of university degrees can't solve this. How do you solve it when one government is fighting against another around services for kids? Well, it didn't take any time at all. Up came a hand. And this little boy said, I know, rock, paper, scissors. And you know what? That made more sense than what the government policy papers had so far. I think he should be a consultant. All right, so build a swarm. I don't mean any disrespect, but I think you all know each other for a reason. And that is because you all come to the same conference every year. You get a new name badge. You talk about the same problems with the same people. You don't have many solutions. So you go away and you do your hard work. And then a couple of years pass and you get a new conference bag. And you come together with the same people and the same solutions. And when you go to the government, you go with the same people. There's nothing easier than to clap off a mosquito if you know what direction they're coming from. We target unexpected allies. We actually, when we were starting the work with I Am a Witness, we knew that who our supporters were and they'd sign on, but we wanted the automotive industry. We wanted the postal workers. Because when Canada saw that the postal workers in the automotive industry were signing on, that freaked them out a bit. And here's something interesting, by the way. On my website, I don't do petitions. We'll talk about that in a minute. I think they're a waste of time. I publicly have an opportunity for people to identify themselves on a web-based list of support. Now, you might say, well, how is that any good? How is the government going to even know who these people are? The problem with the petition is I sign a petition and I give it to you as a member of parliament. It's only you and I who know the names on there. But if you do a public online thing where anybody of any age can sign on, you see thousands and thousands and thousands of names going there. Now, what about the question of what is the government going to know what you're doing? Well, I have a wonderful program back home. It's called Webalizer. It's free. And I know every single time the government of Canada goes onto our website and what they look at. And they are, I'm happy to say, I'm actually going to send the Prime Minister a membership for the Caring Society when I get back, because he uses our services more than anybody else in the Canadian public. So you've got to go out there and infect your message into other folks. So as a four-person organization, we can't do it. And the greatest group for us are the children themselves. The children you saw in those rallies after they went to court, it all started with about five kids who came to court, and then they went out and did presentations to other schools. So we've gone from five kids to 100 kids to 200 kids to 700 kids. And we just had an event in June where we had 6,000 children all over Canada marching with letters to the Prime Minister. And over the summer break, which just ended, the kids would actually be out still doing presentations to their clubs and everything else over the summer break. So Prime Minister Harper better get ready. I hope he's building a bigger mailbox, because more is going to happen. You've got to engage the public in the solution. This is called public health for a reason. And don't underestimate the intelligence and ability of people to want to help. Give them something they can do that's free in under 2 minutes. And don't make it just age or sector available. So everything we do is completely free, and I mean that. I mean, don't do food drives even. I won't do food drives with kids, because some of those kids who bring the food have to bring it from the food bank itself. You want to make sure it's an equal playing field for everybody. The buzz, you got to have a good public speaker. You really do. You need more than one, and you need a storyteller is what you need. Locate what you're doing within the stories of just a few children. Don't use thousands and thousands of statistics. Sadly, when you say something affects thousands, it goes into a blank hole. And Lakoff tells us we need a symbol to locate that, a child to represent that. Use Facebook and Twitter. And Mario Cuomo, who is a Democrat in the United States, is one of the best public speakers, and he writes a great book called More Than Words to Say on how to do public speaking. And I also have my own tip sheet, because I'm a graduate of the Scared Stiff School of Public Speaking. And so I have my own tip sheet up on our website. The other thing is to come from all directions. Oh my God, we're so lame, adults, you know? We're gonna have a rally, they say. How easy is that for government to plan for? They know there's going to be a couple hits in the media that day. Things might be a bit uncomfortable. They come out with a statement. They say, we're working on it. And then they get a whole free 363 days until your rally happens again next year. You're going to keep at them all the time. So we do things like access to information requests, because it freaks them out on the inside when you're trying to figure out what's going on. We have kids writing letters, we do media reports, we use documentaries. We actually have been gifted, and you'll hear it in a moment, a songwriter has written protest songs for us. The kids are having their own galleries and things all throughout the year. There is never really a moment where something isn't happening. And it's gotten to the point now where I don't even know what's happening, because the kids are just taking the movement and making it bigger. So while I was here, I got an article from a child from the East Indian community who on his own had written a whole article for one of the largest Indo-Canadian newspaper on why it's so important that we all stand up for First Nations kids. So you don't know what's happening, but that's the good part of it. Be persistent. Don't give up. And don't rely on them doing it because they're good and moral. I want Canada to move towards equity for kids, and I don't care if they do it because they're irritated. That's fine with me. I'm happy if they do the right thing because we irritate the heck out of them. Sure, I'd like it if they were nice and moral and would do the right thing, but they haven't shown it that they're going in that direction yet. And then here's the most difficult one at all, is what are you prepared to do? Are you prepared to take your government to court? What is the bite? You notice mosquitoes, by the way, not all of them bite. Only the females do. And so they don't really know if you're dealing with one of the peaceful males or if you're dealing with a female. But you do have to have something like this. That's because I go to the Government of Canada, and I remember in the early days we used to do this. I used to say to them, you know, you will treat First Nations children equitably. And I would say to the Prime Minister's staff, when this is at the time when I actually could get close to the Prime Minister's staff, and say, you know, Prime Minister, I don't know if what you're going to do is to treat these kids equitably or not. I just know that in the history of the world, those great leaders that we so laud and remember years after their term has ended have been those who stood up courageously against racism when many others were silent. Or I don't know if you're going to fight to continue this legacy that the Canadian government has of racial discrimination against kids. That really is a matter of conscience. The only thing I can promise you is I will make you famous for whatever choice you make. So, you know, it might be easier getting out of New Zealand than getting back home, we'll see. Now, what about being small? This is a sign actually made by the kids. I stole it from them. Just because you're small doesn't mean we can't stand tall. You know, if you think about really the great social movements of our time, it's never been a big actor who's taken out a big actor when they've been doing the wrong thing. It's always been small groups. You've got to embrace the fact you're small. Mosquitoes are effective because they're small. If bears were trying to do what mosquitoes would do, like a bear you can see coming, let me tell you, folks. They don't sneak up on you, right? Especially our grizzly bears, right? They're there. But mosquitoes are small and agile. They are quick, they are passionate, and they have heart. And they're also much more brave because they don't have as much to lose. They don't have to, when I'm making a decision at the Caring Society regarding our campaign, I don't have 5 layers of approval on my press release. I go to the press department, which would be me. I write up what I want to say. I go to the approval department, which happens to be me. And then I get onto Newswire, and I put it on Newswire. And here's a little tip for you. Because we're broke, Newswire costs a lot of money back home. I don't know what your Newswire is here. But I was sitting, I had written this one up about the court case, and I was thinking, now, how do I get the world's media to know it? And I saw the box to check off for the world's media, but that was way beyond what I could afford. And then I looked and I thought to myself, where is the world's media always? Washington, D.C. I will just feed it right into there. And so we got coverage from all over the world, Al Jazeera and everything else, just from checking that box. So the big guys are well-resourced, but they're slow. They're lethargic, they are not creative, and when they take on the small guy, they look like a bully. They get very little public sympathy. I mean, Canada would have a big glossy, we've got signs, Canada's Economic Action Plan. If the Prime Minister was here, he'd have it behind you, all professionally designed. But check out our signs. Which ones do you like better? I can tell you, as a taxpayer who paid $100 million for the Prime Minister's signs, they are some of the ugliest designs I've ever seen. Here's a book you all should read, MacLibel, about the little small taking on the big. This is a postal worker and a gardener who take on McDonald's Corporation. And they were out there handing out leaflets below McDonald's headquarters in the UK. And the UK's libel laws are structured in such a way that it really makes it very easy to squash free speech. Now, a lot of people had tried to, particularly news outlets in the UK, had tried to take McDonald's to account for various issues over the past. But when the legal team of McDonald's was unleashed, you would find news reporters on the TV saying, oh, we regret the story we did on that, and we offer McDonald's our apologies. Well, enter the gardener and the postal worker, who are outside of McDonald's corporations, and they're handing out leaflets. called What's Wrong with McDonald's? And they're alleging that McDonald's food is not that nutritious, and that the wages suck, and that they're exploiting the environment, among other issues. Now, McDonald's Corporation looks down at these peons down there with their cheap signs and leaflets, and they say, we're making a call down to legal. So they decide to sue these two for libel. Now, McDonald's Corporation is going to spend hundreds of millions of pounds on their legal team. These two decide to represent themselves. And there they are, members of the public. The news media get onto this. You have McDonald's Corporation walking in with this multi-million dollar legal team, and then you have the postal worker and the gardener coming in with their handmade signs. Well, in the end of this very long court case, it turns out, and I know this is going to shock all of us here, that the food at McDonald's is not that nutritious. And the wages are not that great. But because Helen and Dave weren't able to prove the rainforest allegation, the court actually made a financial judgment against them. But it was such a it was public relations nightmare for McDonald's Corporation that McDonald's Corporation immediately went out and told the public they would not collect on this. And they actually had to do substantial changes. So there is no better example of how the small can take on the big than the McLibel case, and I recommend it to you. What about courage? In our various societies, we really laud physical courage. I saw three examples of moral courage last night, though. And congratulations to all of you. You very much deserve it. And you are fine examples of those who stand so courageous. But Rutherford Kidder tells us that there's two types of courage, the physical courage, and that's the easy one. It's easy, and not to minimize the contributions of people, but then there's moral courage. We reward physical courage, those who rescue children from burning buildings or get sent off to war. And even these days, if you're battling cancer, you're automatically courageous. But we punish moral courage. We call it disloyalty, rocking the boat, unpatriotic, troublemaker, too political, passionate. And Rutherford Kidder argues that in social justice, it's really moral courage that we need the most. He also says something that's difficult. Is as much as we all believe that we're altruistic, the rubber really hits the road on who is going to benefit from your moral courage. At that moment when you're sitting around the meeting table and someone says something absolutely unacceptable, are you going to say something? You're more likely to say something if it affects you or your family or those you love than you are if it's a stranger. And let's face it, the thousands of children that we've been talking about these days often are strangers to us. They will not know that we stood up and took the hit for them. They will not know to be thankful to us. And most importantly, when we make these decisions, if we're really honest, they won't know if we kept our mouths shut. So some of us say, well, they won't know, so I'm not going to say anything. And we comfort ourselves by saying, we'll do something later, and we often don't. So as an organization, if you're going to do something like we're doing, when we were created, an elder from the Cree Nation in Northern Ontario said, what are you prepared to die for as an organization? I want you to tell me that, or if you aren't able to say that, then I don't ever want you to become an organization. And what we decided, it was the equity of these First Nations kids. And he said, okay, never fall in love with this organization. Never fall in love with it. Never fall in love with your profession. Never fall in love with your title. Only fall in love with the kids. Because if you don't fall in love with the kids, you'll always find ways of saving the organization under the guise of doing what's best for the kids. So you have to decide what you're prepared to risk. Are you prepared to be cut like we were and not know if you're going to survive? What is amazing is we are now sustainable for 10 years thanks to the fundraising of the kids. So the government, we're actually much more flexible and better funded than we were under the government regime, but that's because we bit the hand that fed us and because of the generosity of kids. But there's another piece too. What are you personally prepared for? In this whole undertaking, I have understood that there is a personal situation that happens. In a government like mine, where democracy is supposed to reign, can you imagine my surprise when I realized that there I was the subject of what the Toronto Star would call spying in its reporting. Others have called monitoring. But the government of Canada taking a significant interest in my personal and public affairs. So significant that they have logged into my personal Facebook and Twitter accounts. There's an email through Access to Information that says, from the Aboriginal Affairs Ministry saying, we applied to monitor her Facebook and Twitter accounts for 6 months, but we stopped because we realized the Department of Justice was also monitoring, and they could share the information. I was so happy as a taxpayer. There's efficiency in my tax dollars. Now, you might wonder why they were following me. Well, there you go. The context of the department looking at her, which is me, Facebook and Twitter accounts is because she was posting court documents and making other comments about her. Notice this, her litigation. I am not a litigant in this case. It is the Caring Society on behalf of kids. I am an employee of that organization, but they've personalized the case. And making other relevance about her litigation, and which could ultimately affect the litigation and ultimately show she has other motives for the child welfare case. You are going to find, if you take it to this level, how the limits of democracy are for your country. And so you have to decide how courageous you're going to be and what you're prepared to give up. What did I do when I found this out? I called my friends at CBC The Current and I went on TV and I shared the information. But you notice that I didn't release the name of the bureaucrat who wrote those documents or over the other thousands of documents I have, because I'm not going to reciprocate with the lack of class that the Canadian government dishes out. We have to stand by our values and make sure that we do the proper thing. There's Lakoff's book. Here's something, an example of something specific. Did someone hand out the bookmarks to you that I brought? Can you hand them out? Each one of these bookmarks, hold them up. That's a website for this URL. I absolutely expect every single one of you to sign on and do something. It's under 2 minutes, it's completely free, it's on Facebook, it's on Twitter, and it's on this web. So you, when you're coming up with something, do that. Give them something like that. They're bilingual. We actually have buttons. We have all kinds of things. So make it easy for people to do something. And then people will often do more. So that's my mosquito advocacy, at least a little bit of a glimpse of the tops of the mountains. And I don't know if it's that helpful for you. But if Wesley Prankert were here, he would tell you the most important thing is for you to do something. Some of you may have heard the story of Attawapiskat First Nation. It is one of our communities where there's one potable source of water, where people are living in tents. The temperature there in the winter plummets as low as 40 to 50 below zero, plus the wind chill factor. Many of the homes do not have heat. We use fires. And the children are getting burnt because they have to go so close to the fire just to try to keep warm. The school sits on top of a toxic waste dump of over 30,000 gallons of diesel fuel. Now, you might say this is because it's remote. Well, you're only remote in Canada unless the Canadian government finds diamond oils or minerals under your soil. Because only 60 kilometers away is De Beers Diamond Mine, and Canada moved heaven and earth to make sure the highest tech equipment is available there, but they left those kids in the dark. Now, Wesley Prankert, his dad went up to Attawapiskat, and he's coming home to Niagara Falls, Ontario, where Wesley lives, and around the dinner table, he's sharing with Wesley and the rest of his brothers and sisters what he saw up there. And Wesley could not believe it. His school had been fundraising for kids in Africa who were quite honestly living in better conditions than these kids were. So he said to his mother and dad, he said, "We gotta do something." He was 11 years old. What does an 11-year-old do? doesn't have a university degree or all the training that you have, doesn't have the traditional knowledge that many of you have. What is an 11-year-old going to do about that? Well, he figures out that if they can live in tents, so can he, for his March break. So he pitches the tent in the Niagara Falls campground, and he brings his computer along, and he's on Facebook and Twitter and everything, and he asks people to pledge dollars for the number of days that he's out there. And because he's cute, the news shows up. Right? That's the other thing about my gatherings, is if you have a bunch of adults out there with bullhorns, who cares? But my particular constituency is super cute. So whenever the tourists get off the buses in Ottawa and we're there, they're all around us getting their pictures taken with us. We get the tourists there with their arms around the kids, and the kids give them an I am a witness button. So Wesley raises $5,000. And his goal is, he can't believe that these kids don't have a playground up there. He knows it's nothing, it's a small thing, but he thinks it's a place for hope. But he, so he goes to the local toy company, and he says, I'm trying to raise money for First Nations playgrounds. And will you match dollar for dollar whatever I make? Now, the CEO might have thought to himself, what's a couple of car washes? Ah, yes, we'll do it. So the kid enters another contest run by Pepsi, and he wins $25,000. Well, unlike the government of Canada, the toy company kept its promise. And in just a year, Wesley found himself on his birthday up in Attawapiskat First Nation. He had raised the $90,000 needed to build a playground in that community. Just before that, the conditions in Attawapiskat hit the international news, and our Prime Minister was in the House of Parliament. He said the problem is the way that they manage their money in Attawapiskat. I don't know if that's familiar here. Somehow, when the inequalities get brought to the attention of the Canadian government, financial mismanagement becomes a racial characteristic for First Nations people. Now, what I'd like to point out to the Prime Minister, and I mean this with the greatest of respect, please bear with me. But when I was watching Wall Street crash, and I saw the pictures of the CEOs who made that mess happen, they were all white, middle-aged men. So I suggested back to the government that if this troubling thing is true, that financial mismanagement is a racial characteristic, then we should never anywhere in the world let a white middle-class man run a Fortune 500 company anywhere in the world. Because what a mess they made. So the Prime Minister says he's going to send in a financial manager. But Wesley went up there and helped. And I asked Wesley, I said, you know, Wesley, he started his own foundation because he thought that other kids needed help, and he was going to continue to do it. It's called northernstarfish.org. Now, for those of you who've never been in Canada, I decided I better ask Wesley why he named it that, because there are no starfish in Ontario. And there are particularly no starfish up in the north. We have the polar bears up in the north. We have the muskox up in the north, but no starfish. And he said, well, Cindy, when I was doing this, a lot of adults told me that I was too small, that these were complex problems, that maybe I should just have a bake sale, that these are things that other people are working on. And I was telling my dad how that made me feel. Because he said, I felt in my heart that I had to do something. And his dad told him a story about starfish, and maybe some of you know it. There's a little boy on a beach. And the waves have washed all the starfish up onto the shore. And the little boy did what Wesley did. You know, children don't walk upon things like this and think we need a logic model to figure out how to do this. Let's get another commission going here. They bend down, picks up the starfish, and throws it into the ocean. And as he's doing this, a man walks along, and ladies, let's face it, it could be a woman, because we do this too. He says to the little boy, what are you doing? Well, I'm picking up the starfish and I'm throwing them back so that they can live. And the man says, why are you, there's no way you can save all these starfish. Look, stand up and look down the beach. This is a huge problem. You can't do it. The little boy looks down the beach, and sure enough, it is a big problem, and there are a lot of starfish. And he is pretty small. But he can't help it. He finds his knees bending. He picks up a starfish. He throws it into the ocean. And he looks back at the man, and he says, there, I just saved that. Children know and remember that love and fairness are really what are at the heart of public policy. If this was Canada, I would have brought the kids with me, because they love to talk to you and share their letters. But because we're here, the best I can do is to share their letters with you as a closing pledge. And they would ask you, why are you treating kids this way? And can you pick up a starfish? Just one. Help us do the right thing. So here is a gift from Canada's children to all of you. So to the people of New Zealand, your children are your witnesses. As you hold this conference and you say that we care about you enough to talk about you, we care enough about you to fight for you, we care enough about you to take action, they are watching what you are going to do. So let them Let them know that you're as good and great as they believe you are. And know this truth, that I am a witness from Canada who will be back in 4 months to see how you're getting on. Pick up a starfish and do something.
Thank you, Cindy. We have another gift for you. This is the Miramar Kendi Samoan Launga Mateng. And they're going to perform to us and be part of our gift to you. Thank you. Kia ora.
Our thanks to Aoinga Mataunga from Mirama. Kia ora.
Thank you. Pa, hofa. Thank you. Yes, we are well into morning tea time, but I think it was worth it. Cindy, we've run out of time to allow people to ask questions, but I do want you to take the opportunity while she was here over the rest of today to talk with her. But can I say thank you so very much for having the moral courage to do what you do for the children of Canada, for First Nations children, and actually for all the children of Canada in doing that work. And we have certainly learned a lot about mosquito advocacy and we'll be pesky little rascals if we weren't before. So thank you so much for that, people. And can I ask you, Cindy, to accept a little tohu, a koha from us?